Taking home the AOA for immersive event is Les Carrières de Lumières, Les Baux de Provence, France. Entering this vast and ancient stone quarry in one of the most beautiful spots in the south of France, visitors are surrounded by giant images projected on the 7,000 square meters of walls, floors, and ceiling. 100 video projectors and 12 channels of distributed sound pay homage to the Baroque painters Bosch, Bruegel, and Archimboldo. We would like to welcome Chief Executive of Culturespaces Carrières de Lumières, Antoine de Cointet.
Thank you very much. Back to digital ages. I'm very pleased and proud to be there and to present you an achievement with echoes to a singular story and to directly to the deep soul of a French village. And I also want to thank warmly the board of TEA, who manifested an accurate curiosity once again to find once again a speaker with a French accent without awarding Le Puy du Fou. Before coming right to the point, I would like to present shortly Culturespaces, the French company which is behind all this. Culturespaces produces and manages monuments, museums, and prestigious historic sites entrusted to it by private owners, public bodies, and local authorities. We are particularly dealing with cultural site global management, cultural site creation, temporary exhibition production. As an example, we manage museums in Paris, as Jacques Marandré Museum, and historical or UNESCO heritage in France, like Roman Theater of Orange and the Roman Arena of Nîmes, and we used to manage the Palace of Pope in Avignon several years ago. The Schlempf Automobile Collection, but also Immersive Art Center and so on. With 25 years of experience and more than 3 million visitors every year, Culturespaces is the leading private organization managing French monuments and museums, and one of the leading European players in cultural tourism. Our main values, which recurs in Carrières de Lumière project, are one, transmitting our artistic and cultural heritage to as many people as possible, fostering a culture of excellence, and three, innovation promoting creativity. But I must also say that what marks our real originality in France today at the present time is that we are never on strike. Most seriously, I propose you to be submerged in the earth of Provence, in southeast of France, in a marvelous village with a thousand-year history. Its castle has been built in 980, and to discover a way to present art in such a place. It's a bit like Latvia. There is 22 inhabitants in here.
Thank you. all that glitters is gold, and she's buying a stairway to hell. When she gets there, she knows if the stores are all closed, with a word she can get what she came for. She's buying a stairway to hell. There's a sign on the wall, but she wants to be sure, 'cause you know sometimes words have two meanings. In the tree by the brook, there's a songbird who sings. Sometimes all on this given.
Thank you. We decided to create an achievement intrinsically linked or mixed with the place. A huge part of the success is due to the fact we did not want to create an ex nihilo project. On the contrary, We had a strong will to continue a story of stone, sweat, and pride. In the Middle Ages, stone was already extracted in this place, but actual quarries were created in the 19th century for extracting the white limestone. Large-scale stone production forced its quarry worker to change mining techniques using hoist and pits leading to the surface. Just imagine, one man to be paid had to extract 2 cubic meters a day with just a specific saw and a kind of crowbar, and last but not least, 5 liters of French wine a day. In 1935, economic competition from modern materials led to the closure of the quarries, which remained abandoned. We always want to remember that our stage is unmade galleries cave. A key word: keep the venue as natural as possible. Our work must be understood as a tribute. So you understand that all of this story is the regeneration of a brownfield site. We are not the first to have part of it. This valley in Les Baux de Provence, with outstanding solid mineral deposits, has long inspired artists. It provides a setting for Dante's Divine Comedy. Gounod created an opera, and Vincent van Gogh painted here, and so on. By the way, the carrière was given a new life thanks to the visionary genius of Jean Cocteau, a French cineast, in the 1960s. He was enchanted by the beauty of the place and its surroundings and decided to film the Testament of Orpheus here in 1959. Picasso was an actor in this film. It was the beginning of a new story dedicated to image. This transformation was continued in the 70s with the creation of a new project inspired by the research of Joseph Svoboda, one of the great scenographers of the second half of the 20th century. We dreamed to create the overall picture while peeling television sets one above the other. I think it was an exhibition in Montreal in 1967. It's now funny to see that the saw marks are nearly the same size of the TV sets they used. The idea is to enhance this era. The huge rock walls are perfect backdrops for a new kind of sound and light shows. For over 30 years, the Carrières du Val d'Enfer, it's another name, I've hosted these audiovisual shows using many slideshows. In 1911, the town of Les Baux de Provence asked Culturespaces to take over management of its famous carrière. Thus, we decided to continue the story with other means, mapping all the walls and floor with video in order to immerse the visitor in a real bath of history of art. Svoboda's dream of overall picture becomes true. Our concept is based on the complete immersion of the visitor in the artworks and genius creations of the major masters in art history, using specialized digital equipment. It is a real artistic and emotional shock. Exhibitions are created as digital shows. They immerse visitors in the pictorial world of a great artist. Pictures are projected and animated according to an elaborate staging. There are no artificial screens. The exhibition molds itself the shape of the walls and of the saw mark of the elders. The format of the immersive exhibition corresponds to the latest digital practice and facilitates awareness of art. Just notice the dimensions of the quarry, from 8 to 20 meters high. It's inside underground, about 3,500 square meters at the floor, and with the walls, it's more than 7,000 square meters of natural screen. When we conceive the exhibition, we have no educational will, at last but not as a first step. No chronological plan, and no academic way of thinking. We just want to share our subjective outlook on the artist we have chosen and create a mood, a strong emotion. Not only appeal, but uplift minds and souls. That's why we want the public to be free to walk inside. If they want to sit, they can sit on a stone, but there is no chair. And the discovery of the history of art will come afterwards. That's why there is neither narrative voiceover nor written explanations. The comments are willingly given at the latter stage of the visit tour. But make no mistake, we do want to tell a story, but that which inspired us. In 1917, we were inspired by the fantastic and wonderful words, and we acted on painters from the crossroad of Middle Ages and Renaissance, about 14th and 15th century, who lived in Flanders, Northern Europe and Italy, Geronimus Bosch, the Bruegel dynasty, and Giuseppe Archimboldo. The exhibition embraces the fascinating words of these painters. We represented these animated scenes of life and the duality of words shifting between good and evil. Their work shares the same excellent factor and incredible inventiveness, in the middle of which visitors can evaluate. Bosch's hallucinatory imagination and Archibald's highly creative and improbable faces are complemented by the joyous triviality of Bruegel's works, whose many figures are inspired by reality. Carrières de Lumière are filled by innumerable fantastical created and allegorical figures. These are depicted spontaneously, I'm sorry, and some are frightening and others amusing and caught up in comic situations. All these characters are reflections of the visitors. Men's vanities, spirituality, pleasures, temptation, and vices, all are evident in the landscape painted with an accurate sense of detail. The show ends with Bosch's wonderful garden of earthly delights, inviting visitors to enter on a phantasmagorical world. The whole experience is enhanced with fitting soundtracks which contribute deeply to emotional effect of the experience. Even then, no historical approach, but with the will to deepen the visitor's feeling. The show's soundtracks oscillates between classical and contemporary music, playing, for example, the famous Carmina Burana by Karl Orff, the Four Seasons of Vivaldi, reinterpreted by Richter, and the works of the Russian composer Mussorgsky. And the choice of using Led Zeppelin as a soundtrack for the end, a choice that some people may see as quite audacious, provides a contemporary interpretation of the Garden of Earthly Delights 5 centuries after its creation. The song Stairway to Heaven goes very well with the painting theme. It takes the final part of the show beyond time and space, a dance of figure in an enchanted garden with incredible scenery, inhabited by wonderful creatures, and so on. I could go on technical issues, 100 projectors, more than 2 million of pixels, as a number of speakers, a powerful show control, and multimedia player developed by Modulo P Kinetic. I could speak about the terrific operating condition, dust, 95% higrometry rate, great experience for the projectors, but I think it's not what I am to speak about. Let me just address 4 advices. First, be accurate to create emotion. Secondly, technology is just a tool. Above all, substance must take precedence over form. I've lost the fourth one. Returning to the visitor, I think it's very important to enhance the experience and value the content. That's why I work to tighten the connection with the castle of the village, which is also under my responsibility. So we developed a lot of activities such as sketches, statues exhibition, the 4 seasons by an American guy, Philippas, guided tour, and so on. And always the same hand, give something deeper. Considering Carrières de Lumière, this entire approach asks ourselves some questions. An interrogation towards the work of the original artist. Does our job deals with preservation, or is it a misappropriation? Is it a diversion or a depreciation, or rather the opposite, an upgrading, an opportunity for cultural awareness? All that enforces strong requirements. Firstly, maintain a close respect of the work of artists. Working with owners and beneficiaries is a good help for that. Not all time, but for that is good. Secondly, we must assume to do a complete work of creation, a recreation. By the way, it's a 3-dimension game. The talent of the painter, the creativity of the realizator, and the soul of the place. If one is missing, it doesn't work. After all, it is a real challenge towards the public. Carrières de Lumière are at the frontier of exhibition and video mapping. Video mapping is a passive experience. There is no transmission, but only thrill. Conversely, contemplating a picture can be an active experience because art is a reflection of myself. Our aim is to complete every 2. Our visitor must be spectator and actor. We have to share transmission and immersion as additional forces. These issues are important because we play a major role in our public cultural awareness. We attract a really large audience, more than 150,000 minimum a year, and at least the half of a visitor may never have been inside a museum. In 1940, we had an exhibition about the Austrian painter Gustav Klimt, and some people phone say, "Oh, it's an exhibition of Klimt, Klimt Eastwood." That's it. So. So visiting a Carrières de Lumière is getting a first step in the museum, and it works. That's why Culturespaces created a foundation providing access to art for children, for those who are from disadvantaged backgrounds, hospitalized or disabled. More than 3,200 children discovered our cultural site, and 55% of them participate to an educational workshop. To conclude, we now have to answer to 2 questions. The first, who? Who? So the next exhibition we've done. So we are thinking about a lot of people, Dali, obviously, but why not Hokusai, Turner, Warhol, and so on? We have a lot of possibility if the rights permit allows us to do it. And the second question is where in Les Baux? But also we can find new venues. We open a new venue in Paris at the end of next week, next Friday, in the 11th district in the center, in a former factory. If your grandmother has a big cellar but don't know what to do with, do not hesitate to speak about it. I thank you for the attention, for your attention. You've seen that my English is not very good, so if you have some question, be slowly, please.
No problem. We can arrange that. Thank you very much, Augustin. What have I got for questions? I want somebody really. You can ask your question, and then after that, Chris Conti's got to ask about how to install in a cave. There you go. Ron Miziker.
I was just wondering, do you constantly change the images, or do you keep it the same all the time?
In some places, the images are fixed sometimes, in others, people can see it. But it always change and move, and there's a lot of animation in it.
So you're adding different images all the time?
Yes, it depends on the painter on which we are working. For example, for Picasso, the Picasso administration said, oh, we want to have one picture, the original one, not moving. So in one part of the career, we have this picture, but on the other places, it always move.
With such a large scale of space to fill, how many projectors did it take to create such a like beautiful?
We have about 97, to be precise. Because the place is very, you have a lot of small place, so you can't use very large projectors, so we must use small ones, and that's why we have a lot of.
Great, thank you.
I'm going to be going to Paris in about 3.5 weeks. I'd like to see the exhibit. What is the name of it in Paris, if I want to find it?
It's Atelier des Lumières. Warcraft, I think?
Yes, Atelier.
Atelier.
Okay, very good.
I think if you, on the internet, you take AMIEX, okay. A-M-I-E-X, it's like Carrière, but Atelier. Atelier, A-T-E-L-I-E-R-S.
Thank you.
Have you considered using any live performance elements, whether it's a dance concert or a performance there, creating a more environmental experience for a live show?
Sometimes, but it's not the way we use the place. But some evenings we have some specific performance. For example, when we had an exhibition about Chagall, a pianist came, and Michael Rudy, which was a very famous pianist, who was a friend of Chagall, came and have a concert in the place, and we have some images. So we can do that, some dance and so on, but only on the evening for our specific events.
I'm looking for a question about installation and where all the power is and how it gets there.
I'll second that. You have stone walls throughout an entire facility. How did you work out cable management power and getting all the data around the places to synchronize your media?
We use optical fiber with a media player to synchronize all the projectors. We work with Modulo P Kinetic, which is a software developed in France. We have some trail. That's a trail on the lower, on the top.
Conduit.
And that was your question, or I'm sorry.
How does this? Okay. You said there are almost 100. First of all, Peter Kopik from WET. There are almost 100 projectors here, and I didn't see any ductworks or anything or any ventilation system. Don't they create heat that you have to deal with separately?
No, we needn't to have. You can see the projectors on the top of the image. No point. They are all on the ceilings, and for ventilation we needn't because the quarry have huge holes on the top, and the wind can go inside. It's absolutely natural.
Thank you.
Do we have any more? All right. Thank you very much, Augustin. We look forward to more.